In this edition of SmartBites, Nagendra Kumar discusses what it takes to deliver in clean code. He is the founder and CTO of Tejasoft Innovations and titles himself Code Doctor. Welcome, Raja. In our conversations, you said technical debt is like fat and clean code is liposuction. A very interesting phrase it is. Could you please elaborate?
Yeah, so this phrase has come out with the intention of, you know, producing world-class products from India, wherein, you know, we think, you know, every developer, as he gets married to the profession, his primary duty is to produce products which are of world-class value. So in that context, you know, we say every day whatever he is writing the code is trying to produce a product baby. And as more and more code gets added, like the way the baby learns each day, the large code also will start accumulating a lot of fat. And, you know, if he's not able to actually, if the future of the baby has to be better, he should know how to grow the baby or constrain the baby in a right way. And that's where the clean code practices starts coming in. So basically, you know, yeah, as more and more large code starts coming into the product, at one side the growth of the product happens, at other side the clean code practices should know which is relevant now as the growth happens, and then start cutting the fat. And that's where, you know, clean, in the beauty of this approach is, it is not like, you know, doctor operating on somebody, and here the professional himself is whatever the yesterday's code what he has written, he is able to he is able to, you know, remove that code which is not relevant or modify the code to make it, you know, scale better. So like that, you know, I think, you know, see, you should understand that, you know, when anything is growing, there is also a fat, and that fat has to be transformed in a way where he is taking an advantage of that. And then, you know, he's leaping forward much faster. Otherwise, then the two options, he's living with the fat and running, he's not going anywhere. Or, you know, he's becoming more better professional by identifying the fat on time and trying to, you know, run faster.
So you mentioned that clean code practices. So can you quick elaborate, what is your view? What do you mean by saying clean code?
Yeah, basically, you know, yeah, when you are trying to achieve something, there are a lot of abstractions coming on the way, which actually the code is saying it to you. For example, you have delivered, you want to write a feature X, and you have done it with, you know, in X way, and feature Y comes in. Now, to position this feature Y, you need to have a creative thinking rather than fitting that along with X. Now, the product will have both X and Y. Instead of fitting them, you need to make sure, you know, what is abstracting Y to be there in concurrence with X, and there those clashes has to be listened by the engineer and see how we can refactor it so that Y can go smoother. So basically, you know, unless, you know, we try to be listener to our own challenges, what code is speaking, the clean code will not come. Most of the time people try to fit X, Y, Z as silos, and that is where I think, you know, some of the places we see they may work independently but not coherently. So my meaning of clean code is nothing but listen to the last code while adding the new code, and that's where, you know, the people will start talking about what is the need of purpose of refactoring, what is the purpose of unit testing. So they are not compliance. They are the ways for you to bring out a world-class products from your own daily experiences.
Unit or dev testing is more often seen as a chore. How should we view unit testing and therefore benefit from it?
Right. Basically, you know, yeah, see, product development, again, we say it as, you know, not anybody can do it. But then how do you make anybody do it? That's where, you know, some of these practices of unit testing and refactoring can help a lot. For example, in a product, when we think something as a requirement, it will evolve over a period of time. Now that one you cannot capture it in a document and expect people to read, especially when they are in pressure. So one of the things we have observed that, you know, if you write unit tests, they become a programmed requirements. So programmed requirement means, you know, even if he forgets what happened in the past, when he runs the unit test, something will break and tell him that you have broken the past requirement. This is something, you know, most of the people should not see it as, you know, way to, I know, I think the business leaders may see it as, you know, oh, unit testing is a compliance from the customer. No, it is supposed to be a way we should do better so that, you know, we are actually saving more to the customer, saving our own professional energy, because it gives lot of inputs from different directions.
So what are some of the key habits to enable me as a developer to write clean code?
See, one of the thing, whatever we say as done actually is not done from the business angle. It, you should expect a lot of problems coming in, and then you should be able to handle all of them. That is something we should keep the scope of done, rather than, you know, as per my project manager, whatever information I have given, I mean, people will say that I am done. But actually, most of the time what happens is, once it is done from the definition of the process, there are a lot of bugs, lot of regressions, lot of fire. All these are actually telling you where the gap is in the done. And, you know, one of the philosophy of, you know, clean coder, as a clean coder, is we don't enjoy fire. And you should never like to be in fire. So with that, you know, then why do you, but fire is obvious because the way we are, you know, saying that. So the best way to clean code or understand that as an opportunity to make sure that, you know, all these bugs and all, everything, whatever is coming, are the inputs for him to make the code better. And that is what, at some point, you will achieve, you know, nirvana, where you see that, you know, the code you have written is actually scaling well, performing well, it is able to, you know, adopt to new changes very well. And that is what we, it's my definition of clean code, rather than trying to measure it as a metric. So as long as the fire you are able to control by a certain structure of the code, so you are achieving clean code, and then there is a great benefit for a product to evolve faster.
So what you're saying is that one habit is understand the done moves.
There is right. Perfect. Right.
Second, what you're saying is, well, there will be bugs. For heaven's sake, learn and adjust.
Perfect.
And the habit number three is, it's not just about functionality. Constantly focus on
NFRs. Right.
And I think the habit number four is, you know, continually refactor.
Right.
So that you don't get into ever the notion of fire.
Perfect. You should hate fire.
You talked a lot about refactoring. So the question that I have is, what is the role of refactoring in delivering great code?
Right. So as I said, you know, we talked about there's a lot of fat in the code which gets accumulated. So if that is not handled properly, see, there are two ways to handle it. Convert fat into muscle, or you know that, you know, it is not needed, so you remove it. So if you don't do all that, it builds up a toxicity. So what actually it means is, any new thing you are trying to touch, people will start fearing to touch the old code, because they know that, you know, it may break, it may be fragile. So best, see, this is one area where, you know, you should employ refactoring if you think, you know, it can be converted into muscle. So that is where I think, you know, eliminate this toxicity and convert it into, refactor it in a way so that it will act like a muscle for the next, you know, for you to easily modify it. So changeability. So most the refactoring and changeability go together very well. So more you want to change, more you will see the ways of refactoring. More you refactor it, you will see what else is missing. It will open up a lot more gaps. So that is a way to simplify or overcome the toxicity which is inbuilt in the system. And most of the time, you know, refactoring, unit testing go together. Because, you know, if you refactor, if you want to confidently refactor, you should have test cases around it. And if you have more test cases, you will also feel more comfortable in, you will avoid regressions which come out of refactor.
But you also mentioned, use the word top-down engineering is not enough and you need to do bottom-up code refinements. What did you really mean by that?
Yeah, basically, you know, yeah, see, we, again, you know, the way we are trying to drive the scale of the industry, they want everything to be they want to get it right by pushing everything by a process, by compliance, by tools. But then if you see them as a tools and process, you know, and then just follow, then anybody would have produced products. And if you see Indian scenario, hardly we are seeing any products. We are calling everything as a product. But it is not even worth calling a project, because if you really see them, in one of the company we have seen, there are so many people, so many bugs coming in, and then they want to hire more testers, and then, you know, they want to ask more from the customer because, you know, it is not stable. So this way, what we are saying is, you know, the top down are only guidelines. You should not see them as end to them, you know, achieve something great. So we should also come out from a bottom up where, you know, yes, after this top down, we are still seeing so many problems. So how do we see from this problem and then give an input cycle to the top so that, you know, we are avoiding in the next cycle. And some of the bottom up, you know, we have seen in even as a developer is, as I said, you know, you have to be more sensitive to bugs. You have to be more sensitive to regressions. You have to be more sensitive to where is the waste happening. And if that waste is happening because he has followed a certain process, he has to give an input so that, you know, process can become better and better. So most of the time, yeah, the loop is not complete if you try to drive, you know, results through one approach. It is a complete loop, and that comes from a bottom up.